Hello, my name is Darius and welcome to the Chess for Knights lecture. In today's class I'm gonna be talking about positions with isolated pawn. Positions with isolated pawn are very often considered as not so great for the side that has isolated pawn, simply because there is always risk involved that this pawn will be blocked or it will be basically captured because isolated from other pawns. So in this lecture I will try to show what could be the strategies for actually playing with the isolated pawns and trying to make use of it for your own advantage. But first let's start with the, let's say, worst case scenario of what can happen if you don't if you do something really wrong when you have isolated pawn and your position becomes really bad. So I wanted to start with this position, which basically is very problematic for white. Black is just better here, simply much better, simply because the knight on d5 is very well placed and bishop on d2 is not the great piece. Knight on d5 is simply untouchable. It can be challenged by this bishop, dark square bishop, and it also can be challenged by any pawns. Basically, it blocks this isolated pawn and gives black sort of free roll, if I can put it like this, in like creating some ideas and trying to win the game. So possible idea for black is just bring the king to evade e7 and c6, then maybe remove the knight from d5 and place the king on d5, and maybe attack then pawn d4. White would meantime react with king f1, king e2, king d3, and maybe play bishop e3, just like the arrows indicate. But then black can maybe push pawns on the king side, maybe also queen side. Create second weakness, typical strategies. Objectively, position is very dangerous for white, and maybe with the best technique it's possible to save it. However, it's definitely very dangerous, and it is something that white should generally try to avoid. But let's see what white can actually do with having the isolated pawn in order to avoid such a fate here, and actually try to win the game and make the fact of having the isolated pawn to its advantage, and create some threats to black and make some good use of having this isolated pawn. And we'll look at two games, actually three games. Two my games and one game of Diego Flores versus Sam Shankland, in which the side that had isolated pawn created really big problems for the side that was playing against isolated pawn, and we will see what kind of strategies the side that had an isolated pawn employed and what could have been. What both sides could have done in order to get some good positions and hopefully to win the game. So let's get started. Let's look at my game versus Dmitry Bocharov that I played in 2010, so actually 10 years ago, and I won this game. I was really proud of this game. So let's see what happened in this game. Yes, let's start from this position. Actually, I can maybe show here from the beginning. Yep. So d4. Yep. Knight f6, c4, e6, knight c3, bishop b4, e3, Nimes or Rubinstein line. Castle, bishop d3, d5, knight f3, c5, castle, c takes d4, e takes d4, d takes c4, bishop takes c4. And here we got the position with the isolated pawn. Here black has big choice. There's possibility to play b6, which is the most popular one lately. It's possible to play knight bd7, knight c6. There was three main continuations for black. And let's start with knight c6 here. This is what Dmitry Bocharov played against me. So I just wanted to start with this game. I played bishop g5. Okay, before starting from this position. In these structures, in these positions with isolated pawn, the side who has isolated pawn should generally try to activate the pieces as much as possible, create threats, look for active play, and create some threats to the basically either direct or indirect, some unpleasant, basically in try to provoke some mistakes, in provoke some weaknesses from the from black side, from person from more like because it could be also backwards isolated pawn from the side who has not who doesn't have isolated pawn and plays against it. So here, look, having said that, bishop g5 is the most natural move because we simply develop the bishop, we pin the knight and the queen, and this makes perfect sense. Bishop e7, dealing with this pin. Rook e1, again developing the rook, looks very natural, preparing some central play. It's basically there are several ideas that you can employ having the isolated pawn. One of the simplest ideas that you can try is simply play d5 and get rid of the isolated pawn and try to get some play in the center. This is one idea. Another idea that is possible is to create a kingside attack. And basically on those two ideas, I will try to focus this lecture. There are also others. However, on these two, I really want to focus in this lecture. So rook e1 makes perfect sense. b6, trying to develop bishop b7, and then maybe knight b4, knight e5, try to block on d5. As we've seen in the initial position, the first position that we've seen, if black can get this knight to d5 and trade all the pieces, leave black with the dark square bishop versus knight on d5, black will be definitely having great position. Therefore, white needs to react very actively and try to prevent that from happening. And here, it was already possible to play d5. If I wanted to kind of use this idea of killing in the center and kind of just playing d5, I could have done it already, but right now, I mean, in general, this is an idea. This is a very often worth consideration idea, but you have to be careful with this idea simply because after d5, very often lots of material is being traded. And this is what happens right now. And after lots of pieces are being traded, the attacking capacity of white here significantly decreases, and black should equalize and be fine. For instance, after d5, let's say knight takes d5, trading some pieces, bishop takes d5, b takes d5, queen takes d5, for instance, takes, bishop takes g5, knight takes g5, and black's position is just probably fine. There is possibility to play h6, there is possibility to play rook d8, for instance. Maybe develop the bishop somewhere. I don't see any problems, there are no any weaknesses, and also not sure what white has here apart from active knights on d5 and g5, which in long run should be basically not better than black's pieces. So position is just roughly equal. So this wasn't that great yet. However, in this position, I wanted to point out very interesting approach here of playing move like a3. It's very often very useful simply because the arrows here suggest, the idea is to play queen d3, maybe bring two rook to the center and move the bishop back to a2 and maybe sometimes to b1 to create this kind of like setup of the queen on d3 and bishop on d1 that basically looks at h7 and provokes weaknesses of g6, for instance, which could be a weakness for around black's king. Therefore, a3 and also a move a3, it takes away the square, the before square from black's knight. So, for instance, if we want to play queen d3 right now, we would have to worry maybe about knight b4 sometimes. Maybe even immediately. But if we play a3 first, knight b4 is never an option anymore. Therefore, a3 is sort of useful move that white can play here. But it's not just empty move like, for instance, would be right now h3 because it doesn't lead anywhere. But a3 actually creates some ideas of bishop a2, queen d3, rook a1 and so on. Therefore, I played a3. Bishop b7, very logical. developing the bishop. And right now, I made a little bit of an inaccuracy because I played bishop a2. And basically, with this move, I moved this bishop back, and I sort of followed my idea of bringing the queen to d3, rook ad1, and so on. I want to, meantime, point out what are the strengths of this isolated pawn, which normally should be a weakness because it's separated from all the other white pawns. But in here, and this is what white's play, piece play, is all about. This pawn controlling more squares in the center and giving some more space for white pieces. Because right now, queen d3, rook ad1, it is possible, and white pieces have more sort of space. So this pawn guarantees pawn space advantage and also takes control of some important squares here. And maybe threatens also d5 in some lines. So this pawn, isolated pawn, has very dynamic, has to be evaluated very in very dynamic way. You can look at it in very static way, because statically, yes, pawn is a weakness, it can be, can fall in the future, but dynamically, it can create lots of possibilities for white to simply use the little bit of a space that it guarantees, and for white pieces to simply develop some attack. Therefore, I play here bishop a2 with the idea of queen d3. But the thing is that queen d3 here was a little bit more accurate. And here again, bishop a2 is fine, but it's not the best, and black can equalize after this move. But if I play queen d3, and someone may ask, why queen d3? What's the big deal? Why queen d3 is such a good move and so much better than bishop a2? And my answer to this is very simple. There is no necessity yet to bring this bishop back to a2. And if queen on d3, white gains essential tempi that can be used in developing the central play plan. Because we can't forget that we have two, let's say, major plans: either attacking on the king side or basically playing in the center with maybe very often with breakthrough of d5. So therefore, queen d3 is much more flexible, because it develops the queen, tries to develop the rook to d1, and bishop on c4 is actually still well placed. There's no necessity to bring this bishop back to a2. So let's see what happens. Queen d3. Let's say h6, bishop h4. So all natural. And rook c8, for instance, looks very natural. Rook ad1. Someone may ask, what after that knight h5? But here, bishop g3, and after knight takes g3, h takes g3. And because we haven't spent time on bishop a2, in very often we may proceed with d5, and bishop will take on d5, rather than bishop comes to a2, and then bishop takes d5. Basically, we're wasting a tempi. Therefore, just queen d3 gains essential tempi in many, many lines. For instance, that's why rook c8, trying to provoke rook bishop a2 again. But no, we go rook ad1. Rook ad1, bishop a2, bishop b1 is still an idea, but there's additional idea of d5. And this is very important in the following line, because knight h5 is typical freeing idea, basically with black, or like with as a side who is playing against the isolated pawn, you want to trade pieces. If you trade pieces, the white mobility of white pieces will be decreased, and then black can simply surround this isolated pawn and try to block it or win it somehow, put some pressure on it. This will be really a weakness, may become a weakness then. But if there are lots of pieces on the board, the side who has isolated pawn may use it to its advantage, because it offers more space and takes control over important squares that, as the side who is playing against, usually has less space and its pieces are cramped. Therefore, here we shouldn't be as the side as white here, and because white has as isolated pawn, we should try to keep as much pieces on the board. For instance, having said that, it will be a mistake simply to play bishop takes e7, knight takes e7. Because we trade voluntarily pieces, and black simply can, for instance, just always move the pieces, takes, takes. Black can play knight d5, black can play knight f4 suddenly. Black's pieces are having suddenly enough space for themselves, and they can put some good. I mean, they can go to good squares on d5, for instance. Therefore, we have to play aggressively, very active, concrete, dynamic chess. D5. D5 is very important, and it's very tactical. And I will just quickly show what's happening here, because I analyzed it with computer, and the lines are very interesting. I don't want to dive into them too much, but they are anyway illustrative of what possibilities as side with the isolated pawn may have here. Bishop takes h4, d takes c6, bishop takes c6, bishop a6. Again, there is no time for some slow moves. We need to play very aggressive chess. We need to basically right now hit on this rook. And black needs to decide what to do next. Therefore, rook c7, retreating. And again, queen c4, hitting on d8, hitting on h4. We are not wasting time for any random moves. We need to play very, basically very, very aggressive and put the, I mean, to in order to get the maximum out of this position. Bishop takes f3, already nothing better. Rook takes d8, bishop takes d8, queen b5, let's say rook c5, queen d7, rook c7, queen d6. White is clearly better. White is clearly better, queen up for rook and bishop and a pawn. Definitely black has compensation and position is still quite solid, but there is no doubt that but basically black is trying to survive this. And white is putting some tremendous pressure on black. So that's why queen d3 was more accurate, because it gives white pieces more mobility and threatens actually with two ideas, not only bishop a2, bishop b1, but also d5 and a very central, very active central play. But I didn't get that during the game. Also, I was not experienced yet back then yet. And I played bishop a2. But my opponent didn't make a good move right now, and he sort of returned the favor by playing move knight d5. And this move is mistake, and we'll get to it why it's a mistake in a moment. In general, as I said, as a defensive side, sort of like more like defensive side who plays against the isolated pawn, you should try to trade pieces. And yes, knight d5 does it, but in very unfortunate way. And we'll see why in a moment. There was a better way of doing this, and usually when you can, you should try to include h6 if you're playing with black or like against the isolated pawn. Let's say bishop h4, and now knight h5. This is the typical idea that I want you guys to remember of trying to trade some pieces. And if bishop takes e7, again knight takes e7. Not queen, because if queen, then d5, white is just crushing. But knight takes e7 and knight d5 then is just perfectly fine for black. Therefore, if bishop g3 takes, takes, bishop f6, suddenly it's not... It's not clear whether white has here anything. For instance, after d5, he takes d5, bishop takes d5, knight a5. I don't really see why white would be better. Position is around equal, and I'm not. Possibly I would have to probably gun for that, but you know, it's white is not better. Here, so but technically it's just equal position. So this is very important idea. Bishop h6, knight h5. You have to trade pieces, but you have to be careful how you do it, because after knight d5, it is also very typical. Because yes, if bishop takes e7, knight takes e7, black is fine. But if we play bishop takes d5 instead, this is what I did. Suddenly, it's not easy to react to this move, because if e takes d5, suddenly not only white has isolated pawn, but also black has isolated pawn. And what determines who is better here is basically activity of pieces. And after bishop takes e7, knight takes e7, bishop on b7 is very bad piece. It hits on its own pawn on d5, which restricts its mobility. And white knights can jump here and there on e5, for instance. And white has several options how to continue here. And I chose two example lines how to proceed here with white, and I think both are pretty much equal. Possibly there are even more. I just want to quickly show what are these that I have in mind. Let's say knight d5. Knight f5, queen g4, very natural. Knight d6, h4. Maybe then rook e3, rook e1, for instance. It seems like white has perfect position. Knights are very active, queen is active, rook occupies the center file. Only rook on a1 is not participating yet, but it will soon, as soon because it will join through rook e3, rook ae1, or maybe rook ac1. This is one idea. Second idea is to play just queen d3, stopping knight f5. And after f6, which controls e5 square, we can go knight h4, for instance, to prevent knight f5 in the future. And then idea again, rook e3, rook e1. And this is what happens. And it looks like white is simply slightly better here, because it's easier to come off the plan. Let's say rook a f8 and f4, trying to expand the queens on the king side, in the controlling the center. This bishop on b7 is simply a bad piece and source of all sorts of that problems that black is having here. Therefore, it takes d5 is not really pleasant. So after bishop takes d5, my opponent decided to play bishop takes g5, which is very natural because you need to take this bishop. You're never pinned. There is no even pressure on e7. But right now, we of course play bishop e4. And right now, this bishop on e4 does very important job, simply because there is unpleasant pin on c6, on this knight on c6 and bishop on b7. This bishop on e4 also looks at pawn on h7, which in some lines could become a possible sacrifice. But most importantly, it supports central play. And right now we are focusing mostly on central play, but we are combining it with the looking over the entire board, because we have to look at this king as well because of this bishop h7 ideas. That's why it's all sometimes useful, I mean very often it's useful to include h6, simply because it gives this kind of like maybe protection for black's king sometimes. In here, white is just comfortably better in my opinion. My opponent played bishop f6, and right now I have had two options. I could have played queen d3 and h6, let's say rook ad1. Queen f3 is also logical because it comes with the tempi, and then possibly next move is just d5. Fully central play, white is simply better here. Also, it's possible to maybe prepare d5 with some queen e3 and then d5 move, because rook on d1 basically can look at the rook queen on d8 sometimes. However, I really like during the game of queen a4. The idea is, of course, rook ad1, but I also, with queen a4, I hit on the knight on c6. I prepare rook ad1, and I remember as a kid, I was reading a book of Garry Kasparov, my greatest predecessors, and he was mentioning about Smith, if I'm not mistaken. And it was some game of Smith, I don't remember exactly against whom, but he basically swing the queen through queen side to the king side by from queen a4 to queen g4 or h4, don't really remember. But this idea of queen swing to the king side, I sort of got imprinted in my memory and I really liked it. And when I had a chance, I basically used it right now. So queen a4, rook c8, and it was possible to play knight a5, which possibly was better move because, again, as a side who plays against the isolated pawn, you should try to trade pieces. And after knight a5, we offer to swap bishops. And after bishop takes b7, knight takes b7, rook ad1. White still maintains advantage, but there is a little bit more space for black's pieces. For instance, knight d6. suddenly it may be not so clear how to proceed. However, white is clearly better, for instance, after knight e5. Position is clearly better for white. d5 still comes, maybe knight comes to c6. You never can take on e5 because d takes e5 just wins. So I definitely prefer white here, but it's the best defense in because otherwise the pressure becomes just too much. So you need to, as the side who plays against the isolated pawn, you need to trade some pieces to kind of give some room to your other pieces. Also, it's possible to play rook ad1 and ignore it. Let's say queen c8, knight e5. It's also always possible, and after takes, and this also looks very, very good. Possibly even stronger. However, in the game happened rook c8. Rook c8, which is the most natural move, you know, just seems like you develop the rook and you try to finish the development. But guess what? I'm doing the same thing, rook ad1. And right now d5 becomes a really, really unpleasant threat. So again, I try to play here with white the most aggressive moves that I can, because if I don't do this, black will need just some time, and suddenly this pawn d4 may become a weakness in the future, and I may have to be forced to defend it in the like unpleasant endgames. And I don't want that to happen. I want to either get rid of it earlier or basically use it for the maximum advantage to improve my pieces, to give some additional squares to my pieces, and hopefully create some threats that are unpleasant and black can't face them. So this was my idea behind all of the moves that I'm playing. Queen a4 is very aggressive move, attacking the knight on c6. Bishop a4 is centrally placed, it's a very centralized piece, supports both queen side, king side center, rooks are in the center as well, rook d1 on e1, knights are perfectly also placed, and right now most likely my next move is d5. Everything seems like it's just ready. Let's see what black can do. And right now, again, the best defense here for black is, again, trade pieces. Try to trade pieces and reduce the tension in the position, give some room for its own pieces, but it's already not great because, for instance, after bishop takes, knight takes, we can already take on a7, at least. It's a pawn up. Probably black will have some compensation, but how big would be this compensation is another question. But it's already possible just to grab this pawn on a7. However, there are also possibilities to play just knight e4, which basically just further increases some pressure because pawn on a7 still is under attack, but having played knight e4, we also create some pressure in the center on the king side. So if black defends just knight e5, we can go knight e5, and suddenly there are ideas of knight d7, knight takes f6, or knight f6, and both of them are very, very hard to face. And it's not easy to with black to come up with the move, actually. Because, for instance, rook c7 seems like defense from protects knight, I mean, covers the d7 square from and protects from knight d7. But then we can take, and if g takes, if queen takes, knight d7 still exists, and we just win exchange. And if g takes f6, before, for instance, it's some analysis, knight c4 takes, d5, very important move. He takes d5, queen a7, and suddenly black has fully destroyed pawn structure. Actually, this black who has isolated pawn, there's a weakness, and also black's king is very exposed right now because of the pawn structure f7, f6, h7. White is just clearly better here. But anyway, this was the best choice from this position. It was the best what black could do. Even if this was already given a pawn here of queen takes a7, because the alternative is what will happen in the game, and basically it's just really, really bad. So my opponent played queen c7. Seems like a natural move to move the queen, you know, to protect on bishop on b7. If black would be on time, next move would be probably knight e7, and black would be fine. But the thing is, if I played some move like h3, knight e7, black would be fine. But that's the thing, we have to play very aggressively here and try to take advantage of the fact that black still needs to play this 97 move to fully equalize. And there is no time for this move. And after d5 right now, white is simply crushing. There is just a very big advantage. And basically it was last moment to play knight a5 and try to induce some traits basically of pieces. Because after, but anyway, position is just really bad because after takes, takes, bishop b7, knight b7, pawn on e6 is just a weakness. Black can play, white can play rook d7, queen b8, knight d4. With such powerful knight on d4, on e4, rook on d7, 7th rank, and weakness on e6, I think black's position is just very, very bad. So it was possibly already the best what black could do, but the position is anyway very bad. And if e takes d5 is met by knight takes d5, when suddenly the knight from d5 hits on this queen on c7 and bishop on f6, and it's really, really hard to come off the move here for black, because if queen d8, then the rook on d1 will be kind of like in a way on the d-file, so of this queen, sort of like screening to destroy this queen, and suddenly it could be really unpleasant after, for instance, bishop f5, because knight c7 couldn't just win a queen next move. For like the rook and a piece, true, but still it's a queen. So, and also on c8, the rook is hanging. So it's suddenly a very unpleasant position for black. And therefore, my opponent seeing that decided to play bishop takes c3. And this is already a losing mistake in my opinion. Simply because after b takes c3, there is... okay, bishop takes c3 is sort of logical, because if e takes d5, knight takes d5 is a problem. So if you may think that if you take on c3, b takes c3, and now e takes d5, you would be fine because knight can come to d5. But as I said earlier, bishop on e4 does support e4. The bishop on e4 does support d5 breakthrough, but it also looks on the king side. And right now, white wins simply because of the Greek gift tactical idea. Bishop takes h7, fully launching the king side attack on the black's king. King takes h7. If king h8, we can just play queen h4, which is this earlier mentioned Smyslov queen swing to the from queen side to the king side. If king takes h7, queen h4, same thing. King g6, we can just throw in one check, again check, and knight g5, queen h7, next mate in two or three moves. So this would be game over. And that's why bishop takes c3 doesn't work. And also I want to point out here, bishop takes c3 would be logical again, but have a look at this king. This king right now has no defenders, no defense. All the pieces are on the queen side. And suddenly, if this king is left out for itself, just suddenly becomes really suspicious of what to do next, and actually position is just lost, because for instance knight d7 is trying to bring the knight back, just fails to d6. It's already because of, it's already losing material because of this skewer or fork on the queen and the knight. And if knight a5, which is possibly the best defense that what black can find here. Idea is possibly just queen c4, try to trade queens, again trade pieces, because to reduce the tension, if you're under attack, try to trade pieces in order to reduce the attacking capacity of your opponent. But again, bishop takes h7 just is winning, and this is what happened in the game. Bishop takes h7, king takes h7, and again queen h4, swinging the queen to the king side. I was really happy with this move. King g8 and now knight g5. And right now the black white attack is simply irresistible. Queen h7 comes, and not only rook queen h7, because after rook fd8 I started rook takes e6. And it's actually important simply because if we play rook takes e6, we could have also started queen h7 and rook takes e6. But the thing is not to play queen h7, it could be a little bit inaccurate, because after king e7, if queen g7, we take on g7 without check. Possibly it's still winning, position is so good, it should be still winning, but white to give some additional options for black here. After rook e6, also is, after f takes e6 will be queen g7 transposed into the game. But if king but there will be some move like king d7, I really didn't want to bother about such moves. Possibly it's still winning after queen takes g7, for instance, or maybe queen h3. Queen g7 is most likely still winning, but I didn't see a reason why to even give black some hopes to escape for this king, especially if rook takes d6 is just very forced. Simply because after f takes d6, queen h7, king f8, queen h8, everything is forced. King e7, queen takes g7, it comes with check. And right now, basically it's just forced mate, because after king d6, there's knight e4 mate. Very nice mate. And if king e8, queen g8, if king d7, queen e6 mate. And if king e7, queen f7, king d6. Now, we don't take on e6 because king c5, king may try to run to c4, b3. Possibly, there is no way it can really escape, but there is basically much cleaner way of winning it, and this is knight e4. Because after king e5 only move, queen f6, and after king takes and here is where Dmitry Bocharov resigned, because after king takes e4, there will be rook takes rook d4 mate. So, having said that, I think it's pretty clear what kind of strategy you should employ when you are playing with isolated pawn. You don't have time basically for slow playing it and trying to maneuver a lot. You just have to be very concrete, very dynamic, try to look for threats, try to attack your opponent's king, create some attack pieces, develop as actively as possible your pieces as well. And this is what you're supposed to do. And this is what I accomplished in this game. Because having quickly look at this, I put my bishop to the center, I develop my queen, develop my rook, to the center, I immediately, don't waste time, I immediately, when everything is perfectly placed, just go d5 and then just take advantage of the fact that his pieces are not protecting his king and just go for bishop h7 and the rest we've seen. So I think it's very nice to know what kind of strategy you should employ in such positions. But let's see another game that I want to show, of Diego Flores versus Sam Shankland. And this happened, let's say this happened, this bishop takes c4, and in this position Sam Shankland played move b6, which is more popular lately and is probably more accurate. And after b6, bishop g5, bishop b7, rook c1, knight c6, a3. Some play bishop b7. It's also possible to take on c3, but after b takes c3, white will have pair of bishops, not anymore isolated pawn, which would be sort of hanging pawns, but with pair of bishops and the idea bishop d3 and then c4. I think white would be better. However, with perfect play, black probably at some point would equalize. Anyway, some play bishop b7, which is perfectly logical. Bishop a2. Similar idea to what I did earlier. Here, queen d3, I'm not sure whether it's so great. It's all those ideas are subject to computer analysis. Nowadays, everything has to be sort of checked with, you know, like on, let's say, grandmaster level of computers and so on. But it's also very important to know the ideas beforehand. So bishop a2 means is typical idea. This is what Diego Flores does here. Rook c8. And rook e1, and this is very similar position to what I had earlier, and but there are some subtleties that I wanted to point out. And right now Sam played h6, which is normal, but there was better move of knight d5, and the idea behind knight d5 is that right now this rook on c1 is a little bit misplaced, because after bishop takes d5, bishop takes g5, the bishop hits on this rook on c1, and there is impossible to play bishop e4 as I did earlier in my game against Dmitry Bocharov. So white would have to play bishop d2, leading to some unbalanced positional play with where probably white black should at some point take on c3, trying to again reduce the attacking capacity of white and try to maintain balance like that. Anyway, position is very complicated. I'm not going to dive into analysis of this. I want to really show what happened in the game of Diego Flores versus Sam Shanklin. H6, which is also typical, bishop h4, and now Sam played knight h5. As I said earlier, this knight h5 is a very typical maneuver, basically trying to swap some pieces and give some room for other pieces for black. And also reduce the white's attacking capacity. Bishop g3, of course we don't want to take here because knight d7 again is fine for black, as mentioned earlier. Bishop g3, knight takes g3, h takes g3, bishop f6. But here, because rook is already on c1, not on a1 as earlier, white has important tactical idea. And again, we don't have time for very slow play like bishop b1, for instance, knight d7, queen d3. Yes, it creates a threat, but it's a little bit too slow because just g6 tactically simply works for black, and black king is perfectly safe. Knight d5 comes, maybe just bishop g7 next, also knight f5 is possible, maybe bishop takes f3 is possible. Black simply is doing very well. Therefore, here white should try to come up with something very aggressive, and this is what Diego Flores did here. D5, very strong move, taking advantage of the fact that rook is not on a1 but on c1, and it supports this d5 move in a way. And why, we'll see in a second. E takes d5, knight takes d5. If bishop d5, black would be fine after knight d5, again trying to swap some pieces. After knight takes d5, bishop takes b2, because you know it sort of gives the pawn on b2, and if not take bishop takes b2, I don't know what else black can do, to be honest. Bishop takes b2, rook c2, bishop takes a3, and now very strong move, rook d2. And if we look at this position, white sacrificed two pawns, not one pawn, but two pawns, but opened the position. White's pieces are perfectly placed. Rook on d2 and queen on d1 put some really, really big pressure on black's king, queen on d8. Knight on d5 can jump out from d5 at any moment, opening this diagonal and open the d-file. After, let's say, knight f4 or something, or knight c3 maybe, white rook can come to d7, which would be very unpleasant. There are some ideas of knight h4, knight f5, maybe rook e4, maybe queen a1. There are lots of ideas here for white, and it's very, very unpleasant position for black to play. Some play bishop c5, and right now there is big choice basically for white. But I like what Diego did here, knight c3, with idea of basically hitting the queen and then rook d7, very human approach. Also possible was to play rook e4, king h8, let's say, and queen a1, which is much more computerish, let's say, and it's much harder to play. But anyway, as an idea of just developing pieces, bringing the pieces to the game and attacking, doing something very concrete, it just shows what kind of dynamics works in this position. I will not want to go too deep in this line, but I will just quickly show one line that it's possible follow up. Queen d6, sort of like maybe protecting, you know, from some jumps, maybe activating the queen a little bit, jumps from the knight from d5, rook g4, rook g8, protecting from the mate on g7, rook h4, rook d8, knight e3, queen g6, and knight f5. And suddenly, white is facing big trouble, big problems on this diagonal a1 h6, simply because right now rook takes h6 is a serious threat. Let's say queen take. If queen takes, then we just can take. Queen h7 takes, and let's say takes on f7 or knight g5 simply wins for white. It's just an example line. But let's get back to Diego's game against Sam Shanklin. Knight c3. Very human, very logical move. Next rook d7. Queen c7, rook d7. And here, if queen takes g3, because you may think that it's just very natural to grab this pawn, hit on f2, white has very simple reply of knight d4, and black's position is collapsing. And for instance, after queen b8 trying to hold everything together, white has a decisive attack after a simple move, queen d3. But again, right now, the threat is knight f6. And let's see what happens after knight b4. Knight b4 hitting the queen and the bishop, but again, knight f6, just takes, and this is simply forced mate. Takes on h6, again, one more check. Take this guy again, bring the knight, check again, because queen is untouchable on this diagonal, king h8, queen h7 mate. Very straightforward, but nevertheless very nice, very nice attack. And white simply after knight e4 has overwhelming advantage. Therefore, the only try, as what Sam did, was queen b8. But his opponent Diego Flores went wrong because he played knight g5 and there was some huge complications, and eventually he lost. Let's see what happened. Knight d8, queen knight e4, rook c7. I think knight f6 was still winning here, but it's very very unclear. He played knight queen g4 and very soon he faltered and eventually managed to lose the game, which isn't. It's if you don't play. If you miscalculate something, it's very easy to lose the game in such a position because you are 2 pawns down, so it requires perfect calculation. But calculation is just part of chess. You just need to calculate. Rook takes d7, and you need to work on your calculation. So knight f6, king h8, queen f5. What happened in the game? G6, protecting from mate, and suddenly after queen h3, hitting on h6. Black started counterattack. Bishop f takes f2, and it's not easy anymore. And after king takes f2, rook takes rook d2, black started counterattack. And after king e3, queen e5, knight e4, queen d4, Sam Shankland won the game because after king f4 or king f3, simply rook f2 would be winning. This is how the game ended. And very unfortunate for Diego Flores, especially that here in this position after queen b8, if he just bring one more piece to the attack, knight d4, his position would be simply overwhelming. For instance, knight d8, because it's hard to resist this kind of like pressure on f7, trying to basically maybe take on e4, trade some pieces, maybe knight to e6, again somehow defend like this. Just knight f6, it's just white's attack is just overwhelming. And for instance, takes knight d4, bishop takes d4, queen takes d4, rook c6, queen g4, king h8, bishop and queen f5 with next bishop b1, and there is no way of stopping that. White simply is mating on h7 very soon. And this would be it for this game Diego Flores versus Sam Shankland. Very instructive that here, after sacrificing 2 pawns, white has still tremendous attack, and you need to again, and I will repeat that again, you need to go for into be trying to find the most aggressive, the most active, the most dynamic moves and ideas in order to create some problems for black, for side who's playing against the isolated pawn, because otherwise this isolated pawn will become a weakness, and or may become a weakness, and you will find yourself in trouble. So having said that, let's finally move to the last game that I wanted to talk about today, and this game was my game against Alexander Motilev. Let me pull it out. In this game I was playing also with white pieces. And it was d4, d5, and c4, c6, knight f3, knight f6, knight c3, d takes c4, a4, e6, e3, c5, bishop takes c4, c takes d4, e takes d4, knight c6, short castle, bishop e7, and this is very similar position to what we discussed earlier. But right now I decided for a little bit different approach. I played queen e2. Not bishop g5, rook e1, but I played queen e2, simply because right now I have already played a4, which sort of stands in a way of developing my queen d3, bishop a2, bishop b1 idea. Therefore, I have to look for other ways of putting my pieces and activating them. So therefore, I came up with queen a2, castle and rook d1. Idea is, again, very likely d5. If I can play d5, next move would be great. Not only I get rid of this isolated pawn, pass pawn, isolated pawn, but also I create some threats in the center. And right now the main move in the theory is knight b4, and this is what I was mostly prepared against. But Alexander Motilev played here knight d5, and I wasn't expecting this. And here I was sort of out of book. And because I focused most of my attention on playing or on preparing against knight b4 move. But knight e5 is also possible, and here I played over the board move knight bishop d3, and here similar idea. I want to bring my bishop to b1 at some point. In case of knight b4, I go bishop b1, maybe to e4. Sometimes depends what I want to do, but definitely I have some ideas of looking sort of at the king side and combining it with central play. And here basically I used a little bit different approach of constructing the king side attack, but nevertheless it was very very instructive and I won the game very nicely. So let's see what happened. And here he played bishop f6, which is already a mistake. He has to go knight cb4, bishop b1, and b6. Again, he has to develop this piece, this bishop to b7, ideally, or bishop d7, bishop c6. If he can to bishop develop to bishop b7, would be is great. Here he can do it, so he should do it. And here there is big choice of moves. Basically here it's very rich position, and white has many plans, black has many setups as well. But in general, it's all about activity for white and all about sort of trading pieces and stability for black. So what white can do? And here I really would like to show one of the ideas that I came across having analyzed these positions. And this idea is rook a3. Basically, we are, as earlier in the previous example, we were swinging the queen from the queen side to the king side. Right now, we are swinging the rook from the queen side to the king side. For instance, bishop b7, knight d5. And very often, let's say rook c8 looks like a very natural move. And right now, we can take on d5. Yes, it's possible, but there is even better move like knight b5. Because the idea of knight takes d5, queen d5, rook g3 seems very natural, but it's not so great because f5 suddenly with bishop on b1 can be trapped. Again, we trade pieces, we don't want to trade pieces. Therefore, it's possible to play knight b5. And similarly as earlier, there are ideas of bishop takes h7. Bishop on this diagonal always looks on this pawn. And this is what happens right now, because after a6, bishop takes h7 just wins. It's just mating attack. King takes, queen check, king g8, rook h3, simply mating on h8. It's very instructive and important to know that such ideas exist. So, therefore, black should play probably here immediately f5, but this on the other hand weakens the e5 square forever. Black is having here some problems with pawn on e6 as well. I think white should be slightly better, however, position is still pretty much unclear and possibly there is still a long game that would have continued if we got this position. Anyway, just to show this, I did such ideas like rook a3 exist, basically trying to make maximum out of your pieces and activate them as much as possible. This was the best play, basically. But if he plays bishop f6, is what he did, I wanted to show another idea that I played here. And this idea is to play h4 here. It's very typical idea in those isolated pawn middle games. Because, okay, if here tactically bishop takes h4, queen e4 just loses. Just quickly show, queen e4 hitting on h7, hitting on h4, white simply wins. Therefore, it's impossible to do it, to take it. And the idea behind h4 is basically... There are two ideas behind h4. One idea is basically getting this g5 square for either knight or bishop, or simply playing h5 and then maybe h6, or h5 to kind of like provoke g6, maybe with queen e4, g6, and then take open h-file and create some attack. So the h4 idea is very nice idea that is worth remembering and being familiar with. My opponent played rook e8. And right now I could have continued h5, which is possibly the best move and the most straightforward. However, I played right now bishop b1, which is a very deep idea. And because I didn't want to show yet whether I want to go bishop g5 or maybe knight g5 or maybe play h5. But anyway, I really believe that my bishop belongs to b1 because if I play bishop on c2, I can really go queen d3 maybe. Still, it's under attack from bishop knight knight b4, and I will have to move this bishop back anyway. So therefore, I thought bishop b1 is a very accurate move, simply because it runs away in advance from those knight b4 attacks, and I can prepare maybe at some point bishop g5, or maybe knight e4, or queen e4. I just thought that I have all my ideas, sort of, I keep them in my sleeve. And here my opponent played g6, which is probably not the best move, simply because it just weakens the king side, and therefore the better move was knight bishop d7, but nevertheless position is already not so great. And let me just show how, because right now this h4 move comes in very useful. For instance, knight e4, threatening bishop knight takes f6, maybe trying to get this pair of bishops. So if bishop e7 comes back, also knight d6 is an idea. If bishop e7, knight eg5. Suddenly this pawn on h4 supports this knight on g5, and after knight f6, it's possible to jump with this knight to e5. And those knights on e5, g5 are very, very unpleasant to face. For instance, rook f8, bishop d2, bishop e8, bishop c3, just developing my pieces. Maybe then rook d3 I can play. Maybe just, you know, bring some more pieces, and maybe queen d3. Seems like white has very good position. We can also forget the idea still of playing d5, because having this rook on d1, bishop on c3, we can open both by sacrificing the pawn on d5, and this would also put black under tremendous pressure here. So this was possibly the best, because after g6 I played bishop g5, which is a good move, very, very typical. I basically made use of this move h4 that I played. However, there was even better move, possibly knight e4, which could have put black under, again, tremendous pressure. Say bishop g7 and either h5 or bishop g5, I think looks even stronger. I mean, both look very strong, not sure which one is stronger, but let's say bishop g5, queen d7, h5, h6. Suddenly h takes g6 is possible. After takes, we can just take on f7. And we will have like very, very strong attack, let's say after knight d5 or knight f takes g5. Both lead to very strong attack, as I checked, and it's very hard with black to face it. For instance, also rook can come through a3 right now, because bishop is not on e7 anymore. Also, another idea is to play h5 and play after b6, let's say bishop g5 then, and then h6 is more positional, but nevertheless, bishop h8 I meant to say, because bishop f8 could be already tactics working, knight like this, and if bishop if knight takes e5, d takes e5, and if bishop b7, knight g4 for instance, looks winning, and if bishop h8, simply bishop d2, it's very positional, but with such pawn on h6, we can't already king, because pawns are on f6 and g6 for black. This seems just like very, very bad position. And again, we keep all the pieces on the board with white, at least we attempt to, as much as possible. Here, if knight black would take on c3, we would take, of course, the pawn, simply because to build up the center and not have isolated pawn anymore. Let's say bishop a6, knight b5, f5, bishop g5, bishop f6, queen d2. Maybe black can hold, but this is definitely not fun position for to play. Anyway, I played bishop g5, which looked very natural as well, because I want to trade those bishops, and if we trade those bishops, this will happen in the game. Suddenly all the dark squares are weakened around black's king. And here my opponent decided to play knight takes c3, bc, which is correct approach, we need to trade pieces. But right now he made a big mistake, because he played bishop d7. And the only way to defend in such positions is, again, to trade pieces, but also activate your own pieces. And right now bishop d7 is simply too slow. You have to already play here, and this is what I was a little bit worried about, but you have to play e5. I couldn't believe it could equalize, but it's anyway the best defense. Because after e5, black's pieces suddenly all start to work. It's pawn sacrifice, true, but let's say after d takes e5, queen a5. Suddenly all those white pieces, black pieces start to co-work together. Hit pawn on e5 is hanging. I can't really defend it. It starts becoming pretty messy. Bishop g4 could be an idea out of nowhere. It's not so easy. But I would probably play d5, knight a5, and there is possible to play, for instance, d6, which looks very strong. Also, bishop e4 looks very strong. Both of them lead to white's advantage. But anyway, this leads at least to some ideas like here, bishop g4. Black can at least develop this bishop actively, not on d7, but develop it actively. So it leads to some more unbalanced play and gives some tactical maybe chances for black. Rather than after bishop d7, I played queen e3, rook c8. Again, e5 was the best chance, and after d5 tried to play bishop g4, but it still doesn't really solve any problem because I can play, let's say, bishop a2 and d6, and it seems like it should be overwhelming. But here, after rook c8, let's say two natural moves, bishop d7, rook c8, seems like the most natural moves. Suddenly, white is winning after a simple move knight d2. And this knight comes to e4 and then to d6, f6. And the rest is pretty simple. White is just winning. There is no way of stopping knight d4, knight f6, or knight d6. And this is what happened in the game, and the rest is pretty much straightforward. So let's just quickly have a look. Knight d7, knight d4. Going to f6 or d6, knight d5, queen d2, also queen g3 was possible, or queen f3, but I really like queen d2. King g7, now knight d6, otherwise I'll probably play bishop a2, or maybe prepare somehow c4, king d9 out of d5 and play knight f6. After king g7, I have knight d6, and just taking the exchange, bishop takes a4, knight takes a8, check, a very important check, because otherwise I would have lost my rook on d1. Bishop e8, and right now I'm just exchange up, and it's just certainly winning position. Rook c1, threatening c4, bishop b5, rook takes a7, bishop a6, just c4, putting some more pressure, knight e7, and just queen b2, king g8, bishop e4, bringing the bishop, and I mean, it's just exchange up, so let's just see how the game finished. Knight c6, just takes, d5, opening more diagonals, queen d6, queen f6, Rook e8, nice tactical idea. Take this. Bishop to c4. And white black has two pawns for an exchange, but black's king is so exposed that it's impossible to hold it. Bishop b5, the best move, trying to cover the e8 square. Queen d5, bishop c6. Here, around here, maybe my tactic wasn't the best, but anyway, it was good enough. h6. My opponent played probably queen d5 was a better chance, but anyway, endgame should be lost. After h6, I just took queen h4, king g1, queen h6, and now after rook d1, I enter with rook d8. After king h7, also can play rook d3, rook h3, and this is where, around here we reach time control. And we played still like after queen c1, king h2, g5, rook g3, maybe it wasn't the most accurate, but anyway, it's winning because after this we played for 30 moves. It took some time to basically bring my king to the center, push my pawns forward, maneuver with my rook a little bit, but eventually I won, and this was I managed to win this game. So yeah, again, very active, very direct, very dynamic play. This is what you have to do when you have isolated pawn, and again, this is what I did here in this game, because I played this move h4. I didn't play like some move like maybe bishop d2, rook c1, h3, maybe, I don't know, shuffle pieces around and wait until black develops all its pieces and basically simply takes over at some point. But I just went immediately forward with h4. And I create immediately some kingside attack, and suddenly it was impossible to face it. It was impossible attack to resist for black. So yeah, that's what I wanted to show today in today's class, and I hope it was instructive, and I hope you, when you play isolated position with isolated pawns, you can come up with the most aggressive, most attacking, most dynamic ideas that you can to put lots of problems for your opponent. And on the other hand, if you are defending isolated positions with more like we play against isolated pawn, I hope that you can basically trade some pieces, reduce the tension, reduce the pressure that you may have to face, and slowly transform to better end games or better positions where you can basically surround this d4 pawn and hopefully win at some point. That's all I have for today, so thank you guys, and see you next time.